This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Seven two one four. Sponsored by the Alabama Department of Human Resources, the Department of Justice, ADECA grant number 18VAVS050, the ABA, and this station.
This is the Miller's Edge with Christian Miller, two-time national champion and team captain for the Alabama Crimson Tide, and former Carolina Panther, and his father, Corey Miller, the pastor of pain, a 9-year NFL veteran with the New York Giants, and University of South Carolina Hall of Famer. This is the Miller's Edge.
This Wednesday edition of the Miller's Edge right here, Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC. Hopefully we've got some good news coming up soon. The portal closed yesterday, but we're going to talk about it. There's a couple things brewing. Wyatt, have you heard some of this news kind of brewing? A couple guys that may or may not be interested in the Crimson Tide?
There's a cornerback out of Houston, I forget his name, so I'm not going to say it, but a cornerback out of Houston that they're interested in, I believe Deshaun Jones out of Wake Forest is somebody that I had kind of heard, and then an offensive lineman, Ethan Boyd from Michigan State, had actually played for Coach Cap when he was at Michigan State. So a couple of connections, and then, of course, the South Alabama linebacker, I believe his name's Khalil Jacobs.
Okay, and there you go. Wyatt always going to have the names. I was just kind of previewing it, kind of going to dive into it in a second, but thankfully, Wyatt is our sports encyclopedia, so he's going to have you covered. But, yes, I know we talked about it the past couple of days. A couple people, you know, called in or left some messages, a little frustrated, right, talking about the portal. You know, going back to before this portal opened up, you know, there was the idea that, hey, you know, it was going to be pretty much, I don't know what you want to call it, exodus of multiple schools or just get a bunch of guys in the portal. I mean, people having their opportunity to get the guys that they need, but it hadn't really been that. And then the few guys that had actually joined the portal or jumped in the portal, I should say. Unfortunately, we didn't necessarily land those guys except the guy from, is it Charlotte? Why is that? He's from Charlotte, right? The cornerback?
Cameron Howard. Yeah, this Cameron is the Howard. Defensive back.
Which I will say, I asked around about him because, again, I tried to look him up on YouTube. I don't think I really found much. I don't know if you were able to find some stuff on him, but I couldn't find much. So I tried to do my due diligence. I asked about him. And from what I've heard, people are excited about him. They feel that he's definitely a guy that can play. They feel like, you know, he can come in here, add some good depth. He's a talented player. I mean, he's got some experience, not the most experienced. I mean, he played a year thus far, but nonetheless, he is a guy that's going to come in here and compete, add some depth to that secondary that also took another hit, another guy that hit the portal for Alabama, Tony Mitchell, a guy that if you go back a few weeks, I don't know if you guys remember, but I mentioned him being a guy, would not be shocked if we saw his name in the portal. And in fact, it ended up being the case, which I think there was a situation where somebody mentioned that there was like reports that he was going to enter the portal. Then he tweeted the cap emoji. But even before then, I kind of mentioned that. I just didn't see him necessarily carving out a role here. I know people were excited initially with this new defense, and they looked at his skill set and kind of his body type, myself included, thinking that he could kind of be one of those hybrid guys. Because, I mean, he's a solid safety, right? I mean, he's not a small guy. I mean, he's got really good size for a safety. I thought he would kind of fit the mold perfect for maybe that Husky spot or, you know, one of those positions where they feel like you need a little versatility. Well, just kind of throughout the spring, just didn't necessarily start carving out that role like many people thought. So not really a shocker there. Peyton Woodyard, I feel like the staff might have had an idea he might be leaving. I don't know the reason, don't know what it is. I think some people have him crystal balled or predicted to go to Oregon. He is from the West Coast, so maybe there's something, you know, that want to be back home. But nonetheless, the secondary definitely takes another hit. So now two young players in the secondary have entered the portal. And really, why? I mean, I don't think – I mean, I'm sure people know this, but if you go back and look, man, the secondary is what really got hit the hardest from this whole thing. I mean, if you go back to initially, right, there's probably a couple guys, I think, that entered the portal before Coach Saban even announced his retirement. And then up to this point, I mean, they've probably lost – you lose Kool-Aid, you lose Terrion to the draft, you lose Jalen Key, those guys all to the draft. You lose Amos to the portal, then the lengthy list of other guys, Earl Little and company, all those guys. So at this point, you definitely need some depth. With that being said, there are a couple guys that still are potential candidates to come from the transfer portal. Wyatt just mentioned a couple guys there. I know I'm drawing a blank again. Wake Forest, right? The Wake Forest, that's where he played at?
Deshaun Jones.
Deshaun Jones, thank you. So he's scheduled a visit. So in my opinion, Wyatt, I look at this guy and I say, you've missed on a couple of guys. I know people are going back and forth. I've heard some people talking about, you know, well, there's scholarship numbers. I'm sure that plays a role. They're probably looking at those things. But I just know, I mean, if you just had another guy or two, just leave. I mean, there's at least one spot. And if you have to kind of pick and choose, you definitely want to try to get the secondary filled. And in my opinion, you've got this guy on a visit. To me, again, I don't know much about him. I haven't watched his tape. All I saw was I think he had like three picks last year for his team. He led his team in interceptions. I don't know his measurables. I don't know his skill set. I don't know much about the guy, but I can say this. The guy has experience. He's played before. And in my opinion, if he's scheduled to have a visit here this weekend, he's a must-land guy. I mean, will we keep it pushing if he doesn't come in here? Sure. But if you have this guy on campus, in my opinion, you don't let him leave without securing a commitment. Now, I know he might try to schedule other visits, whatever, but as thin as we are in that secondary, you've got a guy like this. I mean, the ACC, definitely not the most impressive conference, but still Power 5 or whatever you want to call it, whatever they're called now, right? In my opinion, you got to land this guy. So we'll dive some more into that, talk about transfer portal news, because, again, now that we cleaned up the rules, yesterday was the deadline for guys to enter the portal. However, they have until whenever. I mean, they could commit whatever. I mean, they could wait a whole month, in my opinion, at least to my understanding, to commit, right? So as long as they're in the portal, they're good. So that also means you don't have to worry about other guys from Alabama entering the portal. So that's that, unless there's another window that opens up later.
I will say compliance does have 48 hours to put their names in the portal, so you'll still get portal announcements today and tomorrow.
But they can't make the decision anymore.
Right. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. If they haven't decided they're going to transfer, they can't. Then they're stuck now.
When is the next window? Why? Is it like fall or is it after the season? Do you know?
I think it's that December window right after the end of the regular season.
Got it. So if you don't hear any more names the next couple of days, all right, this is your roster, for unless we get commitments from guys that are already in the portal. So we'll dive some more into that, talk about that stuff. We can talk NBA. We can talk wherever you guys want to go. This is kind of our off season as well, so we can go anywhere and everywhere. With that being said, let's head on down to South Carolina and check in with Pastor Payne, who's joining us now. Welcome into the show, sir.
What up? Y'all hear me?
Yeah, we got you.
Okay. Yeah, my Peter. Sound like Paisel. My computer was messing up, but I got it worked out. I'm proud of myself. I got it figured out some kind of way. I really don't know how I did it, but it's working, so thank God for that on this hump day.
Did you get the garage cleaned out?
Oh, yeah. We got that done. It's cleaned up. I can see the floor. I'm not worried about snakes that I can't see. I had boxes and signs and all kinds. So we got all that cleaned out so I can see the entire floor. Got my trailer backed in there. So it's all good. I'm done. I'm sitting here. I'm working still with this golf event. A lot of stuff going on, getting hotels for singers and, you know, that kind of thing, and people that's volunteering. So I've been been crazy busy. This is what it is. A couple more weeks, 2 weeks from today, I'll be done with this thing. But that's how I raise the money to live, and so I'm not going to complain about it, but it is a lot of work.
Well, give us some details on like what you have going, just in case anybody's interested in kind of checking it out.
Giants for Christ is, of course, that's my ministry that I do that really focuses on men's ministry, athletes, mentoring. I go around preaching to churches, to speaking to SCAs, to going into schools, different programs, things like that. So basically, I raise my own support, kind of like SCA guy does. They have to raise their own support that you know, go charge. Like, I don't charge money to go preach or teach or speak or whatever. I try to raise enough money through this one golf event, which sometimes enough, sometimes not enough, but God makes a way anyway. But because you don't want to be, like, charging. I feel like it's a ministry. That's a 501c3. But I do a golf tournament every May, and we have a good time. We have a fundraiser, VIP fundraiser with a little get together, and a lot of my musical friends will come and support me, which they're doing now, coming in town and play music for the people that come to the event and live auction items and different things like that. So it's pretty cool. 2-day event starting Monday, not next week, but the following Monday. And then Tuesday we'll have golf and then wrap things up. But yeah, it's the fourth year of it. Next year will be number 5. So I'm planning on doing something pretty big for the Cinco, for your Spanish lovers out there, Cinco. And we'll hopefully do a big fundraiser for that. But it's all good. I mean, it's what I love to do, what I'm called to do. And it's a lot of work. But if it wasn't hard, everybody would be doing it, as they say with football. If it's hard, everybody would do it.
That's right.
So
that's right. Well, that's good stuff.
If it was easy, I'd say that, right? If it was easy, everybody would do it.
There you go. Well, other thing I wanted to mention real quick, and we can dive into this, because this is a hot topic, and again, we can still talk all Alabama, whatever you guys want to talk about, but something that's been brewing online, at least if you've been tuned into Twitter, is Coach Prime and his sons, man. I don't know what's going on in Colorado, but I definitely want to dive into this as well. Plus, the last thing, because again, I got to do a better job setting the table. I kind of just dive into things sometimes. But the other thing is, Jalen Milroe, you know, it's such a whirlwind when you talk about this guy, right? I mean, one minute we're talking about how special he is. The next minute we're talking about fans wondering if he's the right guy for the job. You've got podcasts.
Back out again?
No, not that. No, but you got podcasts asking the head coach if he's the right guy. Okay, now you've got a draft network mocking him number 1 overall. Not just a first round pick, number 1 overall to the Carolina Panthers for the 2025 NFL draft.
Bryce Young's old teammate.
So, I mean, again, yeah, right. So, I mean, look, again, this is obviously just a way too early mock draft, but I mean, the whirlwind of, I mean, like the Jalen Milroe experience is just a roller coaster, man. It's a roller coaster. I mean, I feel bad for the guy. One minute everybody's praising, next minute people are asking if you're the right guy. Now you're mocked to be the number 1 overall pick. So we can talk about that as well. I want to hear your thoughts on that. What do you guys think about that? Jalen Milroe being the number 1 mocked draft pick in the 2025 NFL draft. You guys see that coming to fruition? Yes, no. I want to hear your thoughts. 205-342-9904 is the number. You can always download the app. The Tide 100.9 app, that is. It is free to download on your app, on the App Store, Apple, whatever. I'm about to say Spotify. I'm thinking of podcasts. You guys know what it is. I don't have an Android, so I don't know what it's called. I think it's called the Play Store or something. Anyway.
It is called the Play Store.
Do you have an Android?
Yeah, ministry phones are Android.
Oh,
it's a good
wow.
one, too.
You know what? Nice. You know what? No. They actually are good phones. There's a joke about Androids.
It's better than Apple.
I was about to say, if you know technology, it actually is better than Apple. But you know the whole joke that people don't like green text.
I don't know technology. So.
Well, no, but you're right though. They are better in spec wise. They are. Well, anyway, let's dive into this on this next side of the break. You're listening to the Miller's
News. You decide to see if you could save money bundling at Progressive.com and to plant really tall shrubs. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company affiliates and other insurers not available in all states.
Hey, it's Christian Miller, and I want to tell you about our great friends over at Brian Harding Construction. Located in the heart of Tuscaloosa, Brian Harding Construction is woman-owned and strong as steel. A specialty manufacturing firm with expertise in structural steel fabrication, ASME code piping and vessels, CNC machine work, welding, laser cutting, pipe fitting, industrial maintenance, and crane rentals. With a proven track record of over 30-plus years of experience, no one is better fit for the job. For an evaluation, contact
Mind Diamonds. When you see it,
more importantly, when she sees it,
FincherandOsmond.com.
McFarland Boulevard between Edgar's and Local Roots.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
Mostly sunny and warm this afternoon. The high today, 87. Fair tonight, the low, 62. Tomorrow, partly to mostly sunny, the high, 89. And for Friday, partially sunny, the chance of a few scattered showers by afternoon, the high, 86. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 82 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
And welcome back into Miller's Edge. Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC, presented by the Good Feet Store. You guys already know the drill. If you're in any type of pain, foot pain, knee pain, or back pain, make sure you guys go check out the Good Feet Store right now. Let them help you guys out with those premium arch supports designed to eliminate and alleviate all types of pain. Everything starts from the floor up, so your feet are the most important, and that's why the Good Feet Store is the most important for helping eliminate and alleviate that pain. So make sure you guys go check them out right now. Again, they're in Midtown Village if you're in Tuscaloosa. If not, no worries. You can always go to goodfeet.com to schedule an appointment. Again, that's the Good Feet Store, improving the quality of people's lives 2 feet at a time. I know I want to get y'all's thoughts on the Jalen Milroe being mocked number one overall, but let's start first with this Deion Sanders thing, right? What in the world is this dude? I mean, what is going on? I mean, like, I know he's outspoken, and I know his sons kind of follow that path, but I mean, first, let me ask you this. I mean, have you been aware of this? Have you been on Twitter? Have you seen kind of what I'm referring to in terms of Deion and his sons kind of? First, it was the, you know, kind of back and forth. You mentioned that with Cormani McClain on social media. Now, I think there was another player that had transferred in. I'll pull up exactly what he said, but he basically went on the record and said, you know, he was kind of mistreated. They didn't really respect him. They didn't really give him any opportunities, this and that. And he was at the point of tears because of how frustrated he was. And I want to say his son basically, like, quote tweeted it or just said something along the lines of, like, must have been a mid player, don't even know who the guy is. Well, I mean, a complete, you know, slap to the face of to the kid, his former teammate. So I was just like, all right, come on, man. That was pretty distasteful. So then Deion, you know, kind of comes to, you know, to defend his son. And he's basically like, basically backing him up. But then somebody was like, I guess responded to him, was like, you know, basically your son's doing too much or whatever. Like, get your son. And he's like, my son's going to be top five. What is your son going to be? And so I'm like, come on, man. I mean, like, you got to, like, I don't know. I mean, you're the head coach of Colorado. Like, why are you making those kind of comments on Twitter? I mean, do you have any thought? Well, first, have you seen what I'm talking about? And I'll pull up better details. But, I mean, what are your thoughts just kind of on that? I mean, do you think Deion's out of place by kind of taking that approach? You think he shouldn't have said anything online like that? I mean, what do you think?
Well, I think anytime you are a head coach at a any school, but especially, you know, Power Five school like Colorado. I mean, but again, Deion is not your normal coach. Deion is prime. Deion is Coach Prime. Deion is, you know, dancer, the rapper, the, you know, the old him. I think he's got a new you now, which is really good as a Christian, as a believer, training man. But at the same time, he's still of outspoken, not gonna hold back type of dude. That's just the way he is. I don't like it, but I do understand that's how he is. I mean, I wouldn't fool with a player who's saying stuff, but I understand guys take a shot at your program.
This guy wasn't really taking a shot though. I mean, why, did you hear what he said? He kind of just kind of given his account of like what he experienced. Like, he honestly didn't. It was not like he was like this isn't the Cormani guy I'm talking about. This is another guy. He kind of was just saying.
I read what Shador said, and you know, I don't even know who he is, whatever, blah, blah. I mean, that's just the way. It don't really bother me. It's just it's the world we live in, the social media. Everybody can get to everybody. Everybody's got something to say. Everybody's an analyst. Everybody has opinions. Everybody. It's just what it is. I mean, so does it shock me that Deion Shador, you know, came back at the dude? There was some, you know, clapping going back and forth. No. It doesn't bother me. No, not at all. Because I know Deion. I know his personality. I know he's going to, you know, they coach a certain way. They coach from old school, how they learn how to play sports, how coaches in their face, how they grew up in bad places, tough environments, tough family situations. They're coaching, trying to teach kids how to get to the league, how to get that bag, as they say. You know, that's just who they are. And that's going to work for a while. I mean, just to be honest, I mean, it was great for, you know, three quarters of the season last year, and they started losing, and people kind of like, okay, that was good, the story was good, but let's back off. It's, you know, spring game, even though it's raining, people are backing off. He has to win. It's great. I love the story. I love what he's saying. I love what he stands for. But we know, at the end of the day, Colorado has to do better than 4-8.
Right.
They got to get to a place where they're competitive, that they're winning, that they're making a bowl game, or else all that talk is for naught. I mean, even though his heart is good, his heart is right, but if at the end of the day, if he's not winning football games next year and then probably the following year, then they're going to be making a change. So, you know, all this is good for now. And who knows? I mean, Deion was asked, was he going to follow his kids? You know, his other son is there too. The safety was at South Carolina, by the way. Got a scholarship, started there before he went to Jackson State.
Good player.
Yeah, very good player. And so both those guys are going to go to the NFL. Shador's going to be a top five pick. Shador could be the number one quarterback taken, not Jalen Milroe. But we'll see. I mean, the question will be, what's Deion going to do? Is he going to step out? Is he going to just kind of be a mentor to his kids? He says no for now, but he said that about Jackson State and all the stuff he was doing there, and then he bolted.
Right.
So, who knows? I mean, I don't know. But to answer your question, not really. The stuff don't bother me. I mean, I think a player, you know, you leave a program, you move on. I mean, if you start talking about, you know, I'm crying, all this stuff, whatever. I mean, listen, I go back to, this is a soft era of kids today. You can't coach the same way that old school, in your face, tell you the truth. That don't work too much, because these kids are not going to stand for it. I don't think Deion's a bad coach, or we talk about Warren Sapp, the guys he brings along. He believes that way works.
Right.
Some kids going to get it, and some kids will benefit from it. Some kids are not. Why you see that they're active. They get a lot of players in the transfer portal, but they also get a lot of guys that get into the transfer portal.
Yeah, I'd almost argue that they lose probably twice as many players, but, I mean, we'll see if it works out for them. But, I mean, let me clarify, because, I mean, it wasn't like the guy was coming at him. So this is what the kid said. And to be clear, The Athletic wrote this. And we all know these writers are probably reaching out to these players. They want to hear their account of their experience under Deion, because, again, it is very – I'm not going to say controversial, but it's different, right? You heard him when he first got hired. You know, I'm bringing in Louis Gucci, like – I honestly, that was very distasteful for me. Like, these dudes, I mean, I know they weren't a good football program, but I mean, like, what this kid is saying literally lines up. It's not a surprise, because it lines up with his attitude and his energy when he first got hired. But anyway, the kid was quoted saying, "I was actually getting mad, like tears coming to my eyes, because, bro, you never even tried to get to know me." So he's recalling how Deion Sanders basically recommended him get to, you know, enter the transfer portal. He went on to say he was destroying guys' confidence and their belief in themselves the way he did it. It could have been done with a little more compassion. So I get it, the whole old school thing. Again, I mean, Coach Saban was not holding anybody's hands by any means. I mean, you know, more times than not, you were called your number, not your name, right? I mean, there's probably guys Coach Saban didn't even know their name, if I'm just being honest with you. Like, Coach Saban was not, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, he cared for his players. Yeah, he did all these things. But at the same time, like, he wasn't holding guys' hand. He wasn't trying to give you that experience.
Milroe also talked about this on a podcast he did recently, how he was in practice and he ran off and scored, And so the offense is dancing, and then Saban comes running up. Four, what the are you doing? Ball security, man, ball security.
Right.
So, I mean, Saban was doing the same thing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so it's that's nothing new. But I think what I'm kind of getting from this, though, is even though, it's, number one, it's a little bit different. Coach Saban was old. Coach Saban was just, you know what I'm saying, do what he does. It's almost like Deion, like, tries to, like, have that persona so much to the point where it's like, Like, bro, come on now. Like, you know, a little much is a little too much. But again, if that's his style, some people are going to be cool with it, others aren't, and then they'll leave, which is fine. I don't necessarily have too much of a problem with that. My issue comes in where that kid was just detailing his experience. He didn't necessarily say anything. He wasn't bashing Deion or Colorado. All he just said was it could have been done with a little more compassion, not just basically flat out being disrespectful. And I think that's the problem sometimes. People think being real. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can be real without being disrespectful. It's not about being soft on how you receive it. It's just about having respect. And if your coach is not even really giving you that time of day, he's not respecting you. He doesn't care. He's just not even really giving you a chance saying, I'd be mad too. That's natural, right? I mean, you're human. You should be frustrated. If you get mad, that means you care. And so the kid, he cared, right? And if anything, I respect him for not wanting just to jump in the portal. Because that means he wanted to compete. Even though his head coach wasn't really interested, he said, no, I'm going to try to keep competing. To me, I respect that. But then for his son to sit there and just go, I don't even remember him, to be honest. He had to be mid at best. That's unnecessary. And it's uncalled for. Mid? Mid means basically he's calling him like, now he basically said he's not a good
average.
Player. Average, man, like you're not a good player. And to me, like, that's just classes, bro. Like the dude didn't say anything disrespectful about your dad or the program, even though he probably felt like doing it. He actually said it pretty respectful in the article. And for you to kind of just to take that route and then Deion kind of jumping on the same, you know, bandwagon, to me, I'm just like, man, I don't know. I don't like people moving like that.
I just wish they were talking normal English. Cap, mid.
I mean, that's just kind of...
We just say it, man. I don't know the dude well. He wasn't any good.
I hear what you're saying on that part, right? But that's just because you're a little old school. But what I'm saying is it doesn't matter how he said, even if he said, respectfully, I do not remember this young man that I played with. Like, you know what I'm saying?
At least I would have known what he was talking about. He's like, I saw him.
I mean, maybe.
I'm like, dude, come on. I kind of figured it out.
Right.
But at the same time, dude, come on, give me
I don't know. I mean, there's no... Why are you bashing a dude that transferred, bro? Like, I mean, I don't know, man. I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm kind
of... I just told you about Johnson Christ. And unfortunately, a lot of kids that I see coming up today in sports are soft. They're raised soft.
They don't have a level of toughness. I get what you're saying. I do.
Everybody needs a trophy. Everybody got to be talked to a certain way. You can't raise your voice. Oh, he's too hard. He's too no respect. You know what?
But he wasn't saying necessarily about how tough he was. What he was saying was, dude, act like he didn't even exist. He didn't give him no time of day. He didn't even give him a chance to compete. That's what he was saying.
So my attitude would be like this. He got, because I'm gonna make him.
That's what the guy said. That's why he said he was mad, because he said he was trying to compete. Deion said he should just told him to transfer. He's like, no, I don't want to transfer. I want to compete. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Like, I respect the kid's attitude.
May would have said, but you know what? To be honest with you, I know we got to go to break. Everybody's doing it because this coach, these kids just not transferring on their own.
No. They are being recommended to leave.
The coaches are telling them probably they'd be better off to transfer.
I guarantee you they're doing it in a more respectful manner, and they're not going on social media and saying, oh, don't remember that dude anyway. He's irrelevant.
Just be like, hey, get to stepping.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I don't know, man. I'll be honest, I'm getting kind of tired of Deion's theatrics, man. Him and his whole... It's, you're right. Just like you always try to hold people around here to the fire, I'm going to hold his ass to the fire. He better win next year. He wants to be talking all that talk and Mr. Big Time Prime Time. Let's see him win some games, because four wins ain't going to cut it.
Right.
It's not going to cut it.
Not going to cut it, but like I said, it all has... The rubber meets the road. So that's all good for a season. Just like Kalen DeBoer in Alabama, all these folks are on me. Boy, just look at the chirping going on now. With the recruiting, with the... I'm sitting by, I see some of their posts. All the same one. Oh, man, you Debbie Downer. You know, Pastor Pessimist. Look at all of them now. See, that's what I'm saying. It hits the road sooner or later. The truth shall set you free. It will. It'll set you free.
All right, let's take a quick time out. You listen to...
Whammy! You know, basically double or nothing.
You earn, we match. Discover Cashback Match. See terms at discover.com/creditcard.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Wyatt's in a Jersey state of mind. He's got those Jersey beats playing. I like it, man. He's mixing it up. Welcome back into Miller's Edge right here, Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC. Real quick before we jump back into this Deion discussion, because I got some more details the more I've been reading, so I'm going to share that in a second. But got to remind you about Alumni Hall, our friends over there with the latest and greatest officially licensed Alabama merch. You guys know the drill as well. Check out Alumni Hall right now. It's baseball season. Go get your baseball jerseys. They've got all types of gifts and accessories and products, all Alabama related with that nice A logo on them. They got the old school stuff, new school, Nike, dry fit. They've got everything, man. You got to go check it out right now. Again, it's Alumni Hall in Midtown Village. You can always go to their website and shop as well, alumnihall.com. Again, that's Alumni Hall, where the ultimate Crimson Tide fans shop. So there's even more stuff, right? So I guess, like, there's a guy, I mean, I don't know. I think maybe this is the guy, I think, that was quoted in the article. People are kind of going at him a little bit, trying to play him and even Deion, like, quote tweeted, like, because somebody basically pulled up his stats and it showed it says 8 solo tackles, but he had 20 total tackles and like 4 pass deflections. So again, I mean, like, you know, the cornerbacks don't have the most tackles in the world, but 4 pass deflections is solid, right? Well, Prime's over here, Lord Jesus, like, joining in on that. And so I'm not gonna lie, Kid had a pretty nice comeback though. He said, damn, it's crazy, I got more pass deflections than your son, with the clown emoji. So I mean, at this point, I mean, no, good for him defending himself, but, like, now, I mean, Deion's going back and forth with the guys. I mean, like, this whole thing, man, like I said, man, I hope it works out for him. All I know is, man, people with that ego like that, I don't care if that's his whole persona. That's the way how he was when he played. That was when he played, man. Coaching's a different beast. I know he did good things at Jackson State. I don't want to sound like I'm a Deion hater. I thought it was cool what he was doing, bringing the rappers there. It was different, but I'm not going to lie, man. When their egos start getting a little bit too big for themselves, it doesn't end well. I'm just going to say that. And that's what it kind of seems like, that him, his family, them over there, like, that's great that they have that family dynamic there. I'm sure a lot of people are envious of that. But at the same time, look, man, that, like, it's going to catch up to you with that sense of pride. And it's ugly, man. It's ugly. You got something, Wyatt?
I was just going to say, do we think it's Deion running that account? Because, you know, Lane Kiffin doesn't run his own.
He doesn't.
No.
He's got to be. Now, Lane Kiffin.
Like he's got access to it, because that's where the airport pictures and stuff. But you think he's got somebody. But, like, all the trolling and stuff.
You think that's somebody else?
That's somebody else running that account.
Wait, have you confirmed that, or are you just like?
No, I've confirmed that with somebody that I know.
Really?
In the know there. So Lane Kiffin doesn't fully control his own account. Do we think Deion's kind of following the same path and maybe letting, like, Deion Jr. run this or something?
Well, his son does.
His son does.
His son is in charge of their social media stuff, so he could be. He could be. That's a good point. That's a good point.
No, I know for a fact that, yeah, because they had on the show one time that his son or another girl tweeted out on his account.
Yeah, I think he's directed them to tweet stuff.
Yeah, so somebody else does have access to his account.
Okay, well, I mean, that's fair. But to be honest, I've still heard him speak about these guys and make comments in the media. So, I mean, even if it's somebody else writing, he's definitely well aware and he's involved. I'm just saying, I want to get people's thoughts on this too. So leave a comment on the Tide app, because no, I'm curious. Kind of, what are your thoughts on Deion?
Because
I know
they probably gonna not, because
who cares? I mean,
we live in a soft society.
It's not a soft society. Let's hear. Okay, it's a good talking point. It's a good talking point.
I know, but I'm just saying, people, these kids and athletes and football players. They're videoing meetings. They're videoing coaches.
It is a different generation.
They're doing all
right.
These things, and then they try. I'm just saying, but, and I only go by it because where I came from, like when you could get kicked in the butt. Now, I know times have changed.
I was about to say, but just because it was accepted back in the day doesn't mean that it was right.
Paddle. He'll bring out that wooden paddle and fire your tail up. Well, you know, I know things have changed, but let's just be honest. A lot of these kids, I'm not saying the kid from Colorado is, but a lot of these kids, and I mentor them, I talk to them. I was just mentoring a kid, he's going to the College of Charleston Charleston Southern on a track scholarship. They called me in, he broke his leg. And I get, he was down, and, you know, we talked, we prayed, we did everything that I know to do. Talked to him after that, you know, boom, boom, boom. And then he's just like, man, I ain't going to college. Because, you know, just too hard, the rehab. I mean, it's just like, and I'm like, man, do you understand the opportunity that lies in front of you? Like, you can, I mean, get up from a broken leg. I mean, he's a triple jumper. But, like, it just, to me, mentally.
I mean, I hear what you're saying.
And I'm just saying, mentally, a lot of these younger kids don't have that makeup of toughness to fight through.
Adversity, I get
when
that.
Coaches, I'm just saying, but when coaches who are like a Dion, like, you know, I mean, he knew Dion was like that before he went to school there. I mean, I just, like you said, read social media, watch the interviews. You know, Dion is old school.
But that's what I think you're missing the point, because you're just talking about his style. Talking about old school, that's not the point. The kid, that's not what he's referring to. He's saying he didn't feel respected. The Dion basically treated him like he was nothing, acted like he didn't exist, didn't even give him an opportunity. Like, that's what he's referring to. To me, that's where I'm like, I don't think this is in the same category. The kid you're talking about that broke his leg or whatever, yeah, I agree. This generation, they don't deal with adversity the same way. That's why, I mean, you see in the portal, like, when there is some adversity, guys tend to just jump and leave. They start thinking the grass is greener instead of just putting their head down. Yeah. I get all that. Again, you're talking to a dude that I waited here 5 years. I sat here 5 years and dealt with much adversity. No, that's what I'm saying. Like, so I'm younger, but I'm in line with, you know, that mindset. However, I will say though that I think sometimes, like, people they get the two things confused, right? Again, being hard and tough and tough love, tough coaching, that's one thing. But disrespect and not giving
people... Listen, man. Here's my point. I won't say nothing else on this. Dude, if the man don't want you, step on. Like, there's so many other teams. If he don't want to give me a chance and he don't feel like I deserve it or I'm not good enough, move on. If you can't prove that you are, if you can't change the mind of a coach that, hey, I got the juice, I got what it takes to get to this next level, I got what it takes to be a starter on Saturday, then, and a coach don't have any kind of belief in me, then guess what? There's somewhere else I got to go. I got to go find that somewhere else. Like, I don't need to talk about it. I don't need to tell you disrespect me. I don't need to talk about, nah, I just move on. The portal, that's why the portal is there.
He did move on, but they asked him about his experience. But dude, they came and asked him about his experience. All they said was, you know, I'm sure they're just kind of talking to him about his experience at Colorado. He didn't say anything bad about the guy, except he was just extremely frustrated because he never felt like he got a true opportunity. And that dude just said, just told him to leave and didn't even get, like, I don't know how you get mad at the guy. To me, that's probably the most respectful thing he could have said about his experience. Knowing if you're on the verge of tears, that's how angry you are. That's mad. He thought way worse things than what he said in that article. So that's what I'm saying. Like, the route that Dion's son took, I'm like, it's unnecessary. And to me, that's what I'm saying. His sons get that ego from their dad. They got all the money from NIL. They're doing all these things. Like, it shows, bro. Like, you know, even like the celebration thing, like the pointing at the watch because he had like the flooded out watches. Like, again, I get it, and I know people do the stuff like that in sports. I've never been that type of person. I'm not for all that. It gets corny. Like, you know, y'all talk about Jesus so much, how blessed you are. Well, be humble about it. It does say in the Bible you should be humble, does it not? And last time I checked, those guys are not acting very humble. I just don't like when I see people acting like that, man.
I don't think you're doing them, bro.
When you have your celebration pointing at a diamond watch and you're literally putting a diamond watch.
You don't hear shit do out here preaching.
Bro, I'm just saying, man. I'm just like Dion. You look at his tweets now, and like, people always do this. They turn. Folks don't hate you because they really don't know you. They admire you in a negative way. They realize they can't be you. They can't think like you or walk in your shoes. That bothers them. Always smile when you see them because that makes them admire you so much more in that negative way. Dion, but that's what I'm saying. Well, like,
but that is truth,
bro. See, but that's because y'all probably think alike. I mean, I hate to say that, but I mean, like,
no, I mean, but that's true. I mean, just people gonna hate on you, but that's fine. I don't want, you know, you can't sit there and live and get buried in what people hate. You know, you
bro, but he, but he's making, he's digging himself a deeper hole, like turning it into like, oh, well, people are just hating on me. Bro, that's a cop-out. Nobody, people aren't hating on you. They're holding you accountable because you're a grown man beefing with kids because you don't know how to properly address stuff.
No
let's call a spade a spade. Imagine any other coach acting the way he's acting on Twitter. But see, everybody wants to make an excuse because it's prime.
Coaches have it, but it's different.
Nah, bro.
He's different. And like it or not, he's different. He's cut from a different sheet of cloth. We know that.
He's definitely cut from a different cloth than me.
Because the flamboyancy, a lot of people don't like that. And I get that. I mean, that's their opinion. Nothing wrong with that. But people are going to hate on you. They hated on Jesus, too. That's just
okay, see, that, like that's what I'm talking, bro. Like, but see, you're inviting haters when you have that type of ego and that inflated sense of pride that him and his people have. Like, you're inviting that. So that's what I'm saying. It's like crying wolf. Like, oh, I'm gonna flex and do all this and talk a big. Oh, but people are just hating because they want to be like, bro. You're like literally proving like our point. Like, it's obsessive, man. It's like narcissistic. It's, I don't know, man. Not a fan of. But anyway, I want to hear from you guys. We got Turner on hold. We'll get to him. Got a couple app messages. Want you guys in on the conversation. 205-342-9904 is the number. Download that Tide app. Join in as well. We'll be right back. You're listening to the Miller's Edge Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC.
Weekday mornings at 6 a.m. The Martin Houston Show.
Join us for a Thursday edition of The Martin Houston Show. We'll have roster management and recruiting with Max Recruiting. We'll talk about who's in, who's out at Alabama. We'll also talk about basketball. Nate Oates, has he finally got his big man? We'll break it all down right here on The Martin Houston Show with Martin and Xavier. Powered by Max Sports. Don't forget, you can join us on the live stream at Alabama Sports with Martin Houston or always on the radio dial at.
We'll show you how many Tuscaloosa customers are searching online for your type of business. It's quick, easy, and free. Visit mylocalcustomers.com. That's mylocalcustomers.com.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
Mostly sunny and warm this afternoon. The high today, 87. Fair tonight, the low, 62. Tomorrow, partly to mostly sunny, the high 89. And for Friday, partially sunny, the chance of a few scattered showers by afternoon, the high 86. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 82 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Segment of hour number one right here on Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTBC. Are you good? Did you sneeze or are you about to start freestyling?
I'm going to freestyle.
Okay. Yeah, I'm glad. I'm glad. Okay. Yeah, see. Okay. I was hoping it was a sneeze because I was praying you wouldn't try to freestyle because this is live radio. But all right, final segment. Let's head to the phone lines. Let's head down to your neck of the woods. Turner, welcome in.
Guys, how's it going?
It's going, man. How's it going?
Greetings, greetings, and salutations.
I hear you. I hear you. Hey, Christian, did you get an opportunity at all this spring to go try and get a gobbler?
I did not. No, I did not. But speaking of outdoor stuff, I saw Jam Miller, man. He posted a picture of a nice bass on Instagram. I told him. I didn't know he was into fishing. So I got to show him around, show him a couple spots. That he can try out. But yeah, no, I did not get a chance.
I got you. Yeah, I got one. I got one, and the next day I was on vacation at my club, and I had another one about 100 yards from me. He was strutting gobbling. I was hoping to get him back to back, but that didn't happen. But anyways, I was super excited.
Yes,
sir.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Sorry, we got to fill him in, Turner. Right. He don't know the nicknames for stuff.
Sometimes they call some people call them toms, but most people in the South call them gobblers.
Gobblers, okay. Thunder chicken. I mean, you can there's
thunder chicken. That's
there you
right.
go. There's a couple. Yeah. Wyatt's looking at me like, "What the hell? Are you? Hey, man, that's what they call them, man."
Wyatt don't even know either, so I don't feel so bad.
Thunder. I've called him a thunder rooster too.
There you go.
Same thing.
Right? There you
that's
go.
That's kind of like a game.
But,
Kinda.
That's right. Kinda. But, you know, I was listening to this Deion Sanders thing. I'm driving down the road listening to y'all. And, you know, the biggest thing, I guess this is totally my opinion. But, you know, the difference between the player and Deion is Deion's an adult. He's a head coach at a Power Five school.
Right.
And the other kid is a kid. So I don't think that you would have any other coach on social media replying and saying things. Saban wouldn't do it. Ryan Day wouldn't do it. Any other coach, I don't think, would even put themselves in a situation to reply. And it's just like people that argue about politics on Facebook, right? They both look bad, right? You're not going to, you know, it just makes Deion look bad. You know, and I understand he's a different breed of a coach. His personality's different. I get that story from what you're saying. Mm-hmm. But still, I think as a head coach like that, you got to show some class. And you know, like I used to tell my son in middle school, kids would say something and he'd say something back and he'd get in a little trouble or something, or he'd get a little pushing match or what. I mean, well, he's still in eighth grade, but I told him, you know, you don't have to react to everybody, right?
Right.
You don't have to react. And it's like Trump, you know. I liked him as a president, but some of the things that come out of his mouth, I'm like, dude, you're the president of the United States. Come on, man. You right. know? So it's just have some tact and have some class, and that's just the way I look at it. And that was just my comment.
I think you're right. I mean, I don't disagree with you at all about that. I mean, like I said, if it was me as a coach, I wouldn't get no Twitter spat with a kid. I mean, even if he said a negative thing. Now, what Shador said, my son said it, that's what they do, whatever. But as a coach, you got to be bigger than some of those things. I mean, you know,
right.
There's no need for you to try to defend your program and what this kid said, right? And I know that's what right. he's thinking, like, well, you know, but listen, just go out there and win. That's why I said at the end of the day, the rubber hits the road. You can't keep winning, going 4-8, and then, you know, because all this stuff going to come back at you. So, you know, as I said about Shane Beamer, I love Shane Beamer to death. You know, he's big on Twitter and probably more than any coach I've seen besides Lane Kiffin. But it's like, right. you know, you got to start winning, though. I mean, people like it for a season, but when that season gets old, it's like, okay, we're 8-4, 9-3 is a good bowl games.
But I do agree that kids are soft, because I remember when I played football, man, you'd go in the locker room at halftime, coaches would be jacking you up against the wall, cussing you out, mm-hmm. telling you, you know, and they're doing it to motivate you, right?
Right.
The stuff that the coaches did to us as football players when I was in high school, man, they'd have lawsuits on them now.
Oh, God, I mean, it's terrible. It was terrible.
But the thing is like, the coach would get on you and jack you up or whatever, right? And you go out halftime and you'd be fired up. You might destroy that team in the second half.
Yeah.
You know, and then the coaches would be happy. Oh, hell yeah, you know, blah, 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 you know, whatever. So, but things are different, definitely. And that, I just wanted to do that. I got to go in. I'm in Charleston last couple of days, and I'm going to see a customer. But I just want to call and say hello. And,
man, go down to Paige's. Go down and see Paige's Okra Grill.
You know, I went by there the other day. I saw it. Is it good? That's in Monk's Corner, isn't it?
No, it's in Mount Pleasant, right across right there, Shim Creek. Right, come across the bridge.
Okay, good.
Stay to your right, go to Shim Creek, and be right on your left.
They got one in Monk's Corner, but it's the outdoor seating area.
Okay, either one. I know the one in Shim Creek, brother. You'll go there every time you go to Charleston.
Check it out.
I'm telling you, they got some great food, good, brother.
Yes, right, sir. Man. Thank you, Turner.
All right, man. Talk to y'all later.
Yes,
have
sir.
A good one.
Sounds good. You too, man.
Chucktown. Yeah, if you're in Charleston, go down to Shim Creek.
Mm.
You would love it. I mean, they got some great restaurants. great hangout spots. We got a boat, man, boat on over there, park your boat, go get some good food, hang out. But Page's Open Grill.
Sounds good. Yeah,
seafood omelet down there will make you doggone do cartwheels.
Yeah, now that's up my alley. Seafood omelet. That's talking my language now. All right, let's take a top of the hour break. We'll come back hour number two. We've got at message. We'll keep talking about this. Talk a little bit more about Alabama, what they've got planned this weekend. See if they can capitalize on a couple of these guys making visits. You're listening to the Miller's Edge. They do. You're listening to the Miller's Edge right here, Tide 100.9, 1230 AM WTPC, presented by the Good Feet Store.
DirtyPets.com/deal or text DEAL to 511-511. Text DEAL to 511-511. All dogs are unique. Your dog's results can and will vary. Message and data rates may apply.
WTPC Tuscaloosa and W265 CG Tuscaloosa, a Town Square Media station. Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app. From the Fox Sports Studios in Los Angeles, here's Dan Beyer.
We start out in the NBA, where tonight the Heat and Celtics play Game 5 in Boston. Tip-off 7:30 Eastern. Celtics can close it out with a win as they're up 3-1. But playing tonight without Kristaps Porzingis, the Heat will be without Jaime Jaquez Jr. Clippers and Mavs play Game 5 of their series. That series is tied up at 2 games apiece, playing in L.A. tonight at 10 o'clock Eastern time. Day baseball, Cardinals and Tigers scoreless right now in the second inning in Motown. Same with the Rays and Brewers. Major League Baseball handed out fines and suspensions after a brawl broke out between Milwaukee and Tampa on Tuesday night. For the Brewers, pitcher Abner Uribe was suspended 6 games. Pitcher Freddie Peralta got 5 games, while manager Pat Murphy was given a 2-game ban. Rays outfielder Jose Siri received a 3-game ban. Tiger Woods told the Today Show that he plans on playing in the 3 remaining majors this season. That includes the PGA Championship, which starts in 2 weeks at Valhalla, where Woods won in 2000.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
And we're back for hour number two of the Miller's Edge right here, Tide 100.9, 1230 AM, WTBC, presented by the Good Feet Store. Don't you guys love hearing that? America's art sport experts. First hour, man, we really went heavy on the Deion Sanders stuff, man. I mean, because I just... Just a lot, man. I'm just curious what people think about that. So thanks for Turner for calling in. I know we've got some at messages. We'll get to those in a minute. Kind of getting your thoughts on that stuff. Also, I'm going to go back and talk a little bit about Alabama's weekend. They've got, so far, at least from what I've seen, 2 guys that have planned visits. Why did you say it was actually 4 guys that have the visits planned, or just 4 guys they're pursuing?
4 guys that they could be interested in just because of connections to player or connection to coaches on the staff, and then I know, like,
but
you mentioned,
the two confirmed. And those are both cornerbacks, the Houston guy and the Wake.
Yeah, Force. Isaiah Hamilton and Deshaun Jones are the two that they're trying to get on visits.
I know you do your research quick, man. I try to look up the guy from Wake. It's Wake Forest, right? Because I try looking him up. I don't see much about him.
How do you spell his name? Because it's spelled D-A-S-H-A-W-N.
Okay, maybe that's it. But what about the Houston guy? Do you know much about him? Have you seen much? I mean,
I haven't had a chance to do a ton of watching on him yet. My plan was to do that this afternoon. But from what I've seen, I believe he was like an all-Big 12 honorable mention or something like that. And he had a couple of good plays. I mean, he's got 4 interceptions, 4 passes defended. So
Last year in his career?
Last year.
Oh, wow.
So he was targeted a lot, and he seemed to have a pretty good handle on things as well. So my plan was to watch a little bit of him and a little bit of Houston tonight as well.
Good deal. Well, yeah, there you go. So those are 2 guys that are going to be on visits. Again, I said it in the first hour. I feel like you got to land at least one of them. Hell, both would be great. I know some people mentioned them. It might have been KJ, like, whoa, you got to think about it. You know, you don't – maybe it wasn't KJ. I don't know. I saw something about people saying – like, well, maybe a younger guy could transfer. Well, maybe they timed it right, because now nobody else can enter the portal. I know people basically were saying, like, well, if you bring in an older guy, that might make one of the younger players then want to transfer, because they're like, hey, well, he don't believe in me, right? But look, man, number one, they can't transfer anymore, so that's the good news. And two, you need depth, man. We talked about it. I mean, when you're going dime, you need depth, and you need guys with experience. So I think both of them are must-gets, or at least definitely one. But in my opinion, if you can get 2, you need them. I mean, What are your thoughts? Do you mean, I know you said it before, we need them. You think Alabama has to land both these guys? You think if they land one of them, you think that's good enough? I mean, what do you think?
I just think they need, I mean, right now you're looking at depth. You're looking at guys that maybe have played some, that you feel, you know, confident that can go out there and play. In fact, you know, if in fact you lose some guys, injuries, that type of thing, but neither one of these guys make me get up and clap. Just being honest, I think, you know,
even the Houston guy, that, four interceptions, four pass deflections. I mean, that's solid.
I mean, I'm just saying, that's what I say. He's more of a. I mean, if this was South Carolina, I would be saying yeah, because they're not Alabama. They're down the totem pole. But you're Alabama. You should have players that's better at Houston. That's going to be better than a kid at Houston or Wake Forest or Charlotte.
But again, though, without you've seen their tape, though, say that. You can't go off of school like that. Like, that's not a good take. That's you can't do
it
that.
It is because
most
guys go to Winthrop. Most guys go to these small. Because that's where their talent gets them.
At that point in time.
Quinshawn, whatever the kid named from Toledo, every blue moon, yes. A squirrel does find a nut every blue moon.
That's a, right? No, I'm not with that.
But at the same time, if I were to sit here not turning it on tape, they can take every one of them transfer guys from Houston, Wake Forest, Charlotte, wherever. Most likely there's an 85% chance they're just going to be so-so players. Period. Now, could they find a diamond in the rough? Absolutely. But right now, at this stage of the game, the last minute, it's kind of like, you know, you've been at the club.
I know where you're going with this.
You're trying to get that fit in, you know what I mean?
The lights come on and there's only
down the summer's on you. Where's the last dance?
Yeah.
Last dance.
I'm sure our
last chance.
I'm sure our
romance
listeners I'm sure they know where you're going with that. You know, slim pickings, and sometimes
right now,
you got a decision to make. That
Alabama's the last dance, last chance for a corner. So it's like meaning that I'm thirsty. That means that's what y'all the word y'all
why is
thirsty.
Why is dying behind a glass? I'm sure people listening are dying because they like that. That's a hilarious and a hilarious analogy. I can't speak right now, so I've been.
You had a thirsty state. So Alabama's thirsty right now.
Listen, but can I speak some logic into you? Okay, here's a couple of things. Number one, you only can work with what you got, okay? So if there's not all Americans from SEC programs or Big Ten programs in the portal, you can't just snap your fingers and make them appear in the portal and go get them. That's number one. Number two, okay, come on, man. You as a former player, you got to, like, you're telling me you really going, like, what you're saying sounds like something just, no offense to us, like, just some of the fans, but that sounds like your base traditional fan that just goes, oh, if he didn't play at this school, then he's not good. Seriously, man, somebody that played in the National Football League, you've even said more guys in the NFL than not come from these small schools. They come from the undrafted guys. It's the guys that.
No, I didn't say that.
Bro, yes, you said that.
Made up of the lower round draft choices.
Okay, and what I'm saying is you and I both know, do the bigger schools have more draft picks? Absolutely. Yes, the SEC is crushing any other conference of draft picks. I get that. Big Ten, all that stuff. I get that. But if that's the case, should the NFL just not turn on the tape of anybody that didn't play at a major program?
There's a chance that the squirrel's going to find a nut.
Bro, you make it seem like only like 5% of the guys drafted come from small schools and 95% is big schools. It is not
and
like
Jerry
that.
Jerry Rice came from Mississippi Valley State.
Do you know how many?
I drove from your house to Greenville, Mississippi to that golf event. I pulled up, took a picture of Mississippi Valley State, the home of Jerry Rice. I could not believe it. Listen, nobody would have said Jerry Rice would have made it and been the best receiver to ever play the game. No. But he did. Nobody would have said Deacon Jones would have come from the school right down from my house, South Carolina State. Nobody would have said, like, they got three Pro Football Hall of Famers, Donnie Shell. They went to South Carolina State, not the University of South Carolina or Clemson. I mean, South Carolina State has more than both schools combined. Right? So it happens, but I'm just saying the chances are slim.
I hear a fraction of what you're saying. But again, for you just to completely discredit anybody just because, like, again, Houston's not a terrible program by any means. What was Houston's record last year? I mean, I know they don't.
No, he's one decent.
But I'm saying, and if you're talking about these guys, again, both of them led their team. This is the problem. No, it's not coming down to anything. It's not coming down to anything. This is the problem, though, with like the standard that's been set at Alabama. Is where people just like you're doing right now. Why? What was their record?
They were 4-8.
They were 4-8, so they weren't very good. Damn it! But okay, well, correct me if I'm wrong. A couple years ago, didn't they have a decent team? Am I tripping? Am I thinking something
else?
Thinking
about basketball?
Maybe I'm thinking about basketball. I don't know, man. Look, you can laugh all you want. I got that wrong, but I'm telling you right now, though. If all I know is you would never make it as a scout with that mindset. That's a terrible mindset. No, you wouldn't. But that's not scouting talent. You're looking over guys because you're trying to be funny and making a mockery of the school that they came from.
You're missing my point.
To me, you're just looking surface level. You said, if they came from that small school, that's the type of player they are. If you want to say,
I would much rather find me a guy coming from a,
anybody
Michigan.
Would. They're not there. You can't snap your fingers and make that happen.
I would have been in the mix trying to find them guys way before than Kalen DeBoer and the staff and waiting to the last minute when it's the last dance for romance. Because that's what they do.
That's called tampering, I guess. Because
Morgan knows about all that. I mean, so you're like, listen, you can't wait till the lights come on in the club. Your chances are slim. Oh, you're going to get some
there
trash.
Was, you act like there was like a large group of guys in the portal when it first opened like a couple weeks ago. Like it was dry.
It was a myth.
The whole thing was about to be crazier than ever. I hear what you're saying, but who said they waited till the lights came on? The lights had been on from the day it opened. There was never anything in the portal. That's what I'm trying to explain to you.
What you should have done is like Amos and them guys, they let get up out of there. They should have been understanding, doing their due diligence and homework, knowing that those were the best players that they had in the secondary. You cannot afford to allow them kind of dudes to walk out. You get Yay Alabama involved in the situation. And no, when you look at that roster, listen, I got to keep these guys. These guys are played. And so I got to do what I got to do because they're much better than anything I got on my roster.
But that didn't happen, though. We're going to be void
of talent in that back end of the defense.
But you can't control it. You can't control everything. They did.
You talk about this today,
bro. Money. They did what they could, man. I mean, like, at the same, like, look, the guys, if the guys are going to leave, they're going to leave. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's part of it. Like, I'm just saying, man, the problem with people like you is there's a standard that's been set, which I love that we set that standard because that just goes to show how we were freaking light years ahead of everybody else consistently.
Yeah.
Right, so it's a compliment. True. So I take that as a compliment. Mm-hmm. But the problem is, you guys think that it's like, oh, because it's Alabama, anything or anybody that like you act like it's automatically not going to work or it's not worth anything. And to me, like that's just a lazy assessment. And to me, I'll be honest with you, like that disappoints me because I'm like, you know football, and for you just, I don't know, maybe you're doing it for the show or being funny, but I'm like, that's crazy though.
No,
because Coach Saban got two guys last year from smaller schools, right? One came from UAB, and he ended up starting. He wasn't, again, Jalen Key wasn't like the best player ever, but he obviously was a better option than what we had. And did we have five-star guys behind him? Yeah, we did. But obviously, that guy, Jalen Key, was better at the time. Even though he came from a small school, he came from UAB, he might not have been the best player. He might have been Mr. Irrelevant in the draft, but for the team, he was the best player available. And that's what matters, right? You look at Amos, who you love, and you talk about how great of a player he was. He came from Louisiana, Monroe, or one of those smaller Louisiana schools.
That's my point.
That's not a squirrel finding the nut, bro. Then what about all the guys that get drafted every year from smaller schools?
There's a lot of them, bro.
I could understand if you're talking about a reserve guy from a smaller school. No disrespect to those guys. But I'm all with you. Listen, the Charlotte guy, he was technically not a full-time starter.
I'm standing on business by my 8-4.
So you don't know what cat means, but you know standing on business.
Yeah, I know what that means.
Okay.
And I know what that means. But I'm standing on business what the direction this team is going. I'm just throwing up points in and out. I haven't watched 1 ounce of film of this kid. I'm just saying, out of those three names you mentioned, your wife mentioned, I'm going to bet that they're not going to be what people hoping they are. That's all I'm saying.
I mean, again, you're entitled to your opinion. I just don't like you writing off kids just because, oh, wait, I don't care. Houston, Wake Forest, like, but they led their team, though. So I'm saying, guys, like,
I told this to a couple of my guys. And they always you tell the guys that you mentor, you tell them that he sucks
because he didn't go to a Division I school.
I tell them, mom and dad, I just said, listen,
your son sucks because he didn't go to Alabama.
No, I didn't use the word like you said. You say things nicely. It's about how you say it. I said this. Everybody wants to go to major college. Every parent think their kid's gonna play and be in the Power Five. But tell you, I mean, listen, I work with the man. The dude can play. But the fact is, you 5'11". And
I bet their parents right want now, all their money back that they donated.
You're not going to be a Power Five guy. You're going to have to accept Lenore Ryan, which is a good football program. You're going to have a good time. You'll get a good education. But if it's free school, you better take it. And and the dad might say, "Well, my son is this," and my son, "Yeah," but the coach is not saying that, and I'm not saying that. But if this man was 6'2", we'll be having a different conversation. Sometimes you have to tell parents these things, man. It's been honest.
I just don't see how that compares to a guy leading their team.
Your talent level is group of five. Your talent level is Southern Conference. That's what your talent level is. Now, doesn't mean that some of those kids, like the kid running back, South Carolina guy, he was at Newberry. You know Newberry, school right down the road from here in Columbia. Division II. Well, his grades got him there, but he ended up being a better talent than that. He transferred once he a couple thousand, 2,000 yards, whatever he got. He went to South Carolina and played pretty daggum good. Now he went to transfer portal, now he's at Memphis. I mean, listen, it doesn't mean that every kid, there's some kids might have a late growth spurt, might just get better while they just need more time to mature. So these stories happen when kids go to smaller schools, but the majority of them are not going to the league. The majority of them are not NFL players.
Oh, in 2021, Houston was 12-2, so they did, and they were undefeated in their conference. So I was about to say, I knew they were pretty decent. It doesn't matter. What I'm saying is Houston is not – they were 4-8. Yes, they were 4-8 last year, but I'm saying a couple years ago they weren't terrible.
Houston's the Big 12 now, right?
This was also their first season in the Big 12.
So that was their first season in the Big 12. See, and that's my point exactly. There's always more factors, so there's more tails to the tape, right? It's easy to go, 4-8. But then, see, I didn't even know that. Everybody's joking and stuff.
Where'd they go last year?
They went 4-8 in their first year in the Big 12, man.
Big boy football. Where'd they go?
Bro, it's one. You were talking about one guy. You act like we're trying to literally trade rosters,
they
bro.
They went 4-8.
Again, your logic doesn't add up because if everybody went off your logic, none of these guys would get drafted because they would say, these guys weren't good enough to play in group of five. They're not going to be good enough to play with the best players in the world.
I wouldn't be able to pick out that one that's a squirrel that's finding enough.
No, man.
Versus the duds that I want to be.
Like, you're right. They lead their teams in the stats
you play
category.
Safety? What position you play? I've heard this many times. I've seen it. Oh, I'm a safety. Really? What's your 40 time? 4.98. What? You think you're going to play safety in NFL running a 4.98?
Who would... Dude,
I mean, there are guys.
There's not a single safety that's ran 4.98 that was a prospect for the NFL. Like, what are you talking about?
They'd be at pro day.
What are you, dude? I'm convinced you're just trying to. You're playing your character. You got your mask on.
I hope Alabama sides.
You've got more logic than this, man.
And then I can sit back in here and I hate to say I told you so. But I hope they sign him and see what happens. When you're getting guys from Charlotte that was coming to FIU, you're getting corners that was also in the group of five, And those are the best guys you get with all these Power Five corners.
You can't get guys from the SEC right now.
That telling me it's the last dance, the last chance for romance.
And what you're telling me is you don't do homework and look stuff up because you can't get guys from the SEC right now. Yeah, you probably should. Let's take a quick timeout. We got Bama boss man KJ. It's two calls that I know are going to give it. They're going to give you a run for your money. So I'm going to sit back. I need some rest. Now I'm going to let these guys take care of you because they always got something for you. Listening to the Miller's Edge right here, Tide 100.9, 1230 AM, WTBC. Phone lines we go when we come back. Don't miss out on this.
Gift card for Amazon and other brands. Just download the free Upside app and use promo code GEAR for a 25 cents a gallon bonus on your first tank. That's code GEAR.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
Mostly sunny and warm this afternoon. The high today, 87. Fair tonight, the low 62. Tomorrow, partly to mostly sunny, the high 89. And for Friday, partially sunny, the chance of a few scattered showers by afternoon, the high 86. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 85 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
And welcome back into the Miller's Edge, Tide 100.9, 1230 WTBC. To the phones we go. Let's jump right into it. We've got Bama boss man kicking things off. Welcome in, sir.
Hey, how's it going, fellas?
Man, it's going good, man. How about you?
I'm good. I'm listening to all this hate on the radio. But I'm good, man. I'm good.
It's not coming from me. We all know that. Let's just make that clear.
I know. But Corey, you really be sticking up for Dion, man. I give you that much. I don't know what. If the boy had said them things about any player, you'd been said. See, that's what I'm saying. The GOAT is gone. Now the boy is saying these things about these players. The GOAT would never have said those things. He would have said it in between the players, but he'd have never went public with it.
Social media
is what's killing these guys these days.
You're right. You're right. And I'm right.
What?
Dion criticized the cornerback for not tackling is the most ridiculous thing I ever heard. Dion was a great cornerback. I watched him play in college. I watched him play in pro. He was a one-on-one. He could shut down anybody in the league. Dion did not have, look it up. In 14 years, Dion did not have 40 tackles.
Well, so Dion long. Said, you look this up, they don't pay me to tackle.
He's a cornerback. He was criticizing. They're not going to pay him to tackle.
That's why he ain't there.
But then you don't go on social media and talk about these guys. That's what I'm saying.
The guy talked about him.
He did not say anything bad.
He didn't.
He explained his experience. There's nothing wrong with that. Should he just not talk about anything that has anything to do with Colorado? He played there. He respectfully said they could have just done it with a little more compassion, not being disrespectful like that. I mean, like, to me, that if anything, that was probably one of the best ways he could have worded it. Because I'm telling you, that dude probably had way more words and way more harsh words than what he said. It's not even bad.
I said I don't agree with Dion clapping back because he's the head coach.
But it's not clapping back. The kid did not clap. He just said what he said.
That's the point, yeah.
That's what I'm trying to explain.
He said nothing negative about Colorado or Dion. But everybody that's left Colorado, Dion has said nothing positive about any of the players that left. He always has something bad to say. Bye. Good riddance. We're going to be good.
Right.
Come on. He's a grown man. You don't talk like that in the D1 program.
Did you hear me say that the rubber's going to meet the road? At the end of the day, that's all good, but he's got to win. That's what I said.
Yeah, that's what you said today, but I'm keeping receipts because I remember a month ago you were praising Dion how good a coach he was.
No, I do think he's a good coach. I think he's a great young man. I do. And I think
you don't lead young men by criticizing them in public.
Listen, man.
That's true.
My mama criticized me in public and everywhere else.
I can't speak on that. I can't speak on that.
I'm gonna tell you, my mom and dad, people criticized public and church and got beat down in front of. So I got beat down naked in the room for getting in trouble with the law.
Why are you naked?
I don't know how much criticized you can get of being humiliated. I turned out okay. I'm just saying, these kids are soft, man. These kids feel like they got to go to social media. They got to go tell you what went on and why they're leaving. I felt like I was going to cry. I mean, come on, man. Just leave. Go find somewhere. These people are not good for you. Good thing that you know that. Just take off. Go take stand on business somewhere else.
So this is just like blaming the victim, right? That's what you're like. It's like, no, but that's it's kind of along the lines, bro. It's like, oh, the dude, Dion could talk crazy to this kid and say all types of things, bash him in the media like he's good riddance, all this stuff. But as soon as the kid respectfully says that he could handle it better, now it's the kid. The kid should just keep it on, keep on moving. Like, come on, man. Like, you apologizing for a grown ass man that should know better.
So Dion is 50-some years old. He's talking crap at a 20-year-old kid, and the 20-year-old kid is the one that's wrong.
No,
thank you.
I said if I'm Dion, I wouldn't have done it.
You don't say nothing. You don't say nothing.
Well, everybody.
If you're the head coach of a D1 program and you got a player that does stuff like that, you don't say nothing. You just let it go because your work speaks for you. Now. I'm through with Dion because my name is Bama Boss Man, not Buffalo Boss Man.
Now you need to change Buffalo Boss Man. I don't know what you do to change. As a matter of fact, that's your new name, Buffalo Boss Man.
Now, who do you want to board them to sign to the team? You can only get what's there. You can't get no team. You can't get no player from the SEC. Man.
They had chances.
You can't listen. You can't get no player from the SEC.
I know that.
All the players from the SEC, they can go somewhere else.
What about the Big
Ten?
So
team? I mean,
what about the ACC?
Who have they missed out on?
One
that
of the
was
guys
a, that
visiting
was a sure
is
bet.
From the ACC. Wake Forest is that not ACC?
Yeah, that's
the guy they signed. Saab is from the Big Ten.
Yeah,
the guy that they signed.
Go find some more of those.
if they were the people that are in the portal now are not first string talent. They're second, third, and fourth string talent. The guy that left Alabama and went to and just got in the portal, the young guy, what's his name, Christian?
Tony Mitchell and Peyton Woodyard are the two DBs.
Peyton Woodyard and Tony, both of them are 5-star guys. Both of them were third and fourth string on the depth chart.
Yes.
Well, I thought Peyton Woodyard was the guy that was going to be able to play.
He had good potential, but he was running with the twos and threes, but a little bit twos because there's no depth. But yeah, I mean he wasn't going to be ready to play right now, and he decided to probably hit the portal. So,
well, who's better than him? That's in front of him.
Well, there got to be somebody because it was people in front of him.
Well, you got Malachi Moore, Keon Saab, but then Devontae Smith. You got the Red Morgan kid they like a lot, who wasn't as high as a recruit as any of those guys, but has been out playing them. That's what I'm saying. You can't just go off.
Okay, but then he's doing the right thing. He's getting the portal. He's gonna.
How is that the right
there.
Thing? I mean, dude, he just got here in January. He just got here in January. He's supposed to be in high school. He ain't even give it a chance.
Well, maybe he feels like he can go somewhere else to start.
And again, I'm not mad. I could care less. Again, I don't even know the kid because he just got here. Like, I wish him nothing but the best. But I'm just saying, don't make it seem like, oh, he's doing the right. Bro, he just signed here. He should still be in high school right now.
Ohio State, Oregon, Michigan, none of those guys have a number one cornerback in the transfer portal. So you got to get the best cornerback that's in the portal wherever he's from. You're not looking for starters. You're looking for people to come on your team to make.
Let me ask you this, Bama Boss Man. What about the first round of the portal when they open up the first time?
Who did they want that they did not get?
But I'm just saying, didn't they know they needed some corners then? Or are you saying they didn't know?
They're looking for people to fill in on the roster. If there was a sure bet,
he said they're looking for backup.
That's all that's on the portal now. That's all that's out there. You can't get what's not there. There are no All-Americans in the portal, Corey. And you know this.
I'm just saying, then go with what you got. Don't let them dudes transfer. Keep them there.
But you just lost two. I mean, you literally need depth.
Work at keeping them dudes there.
Bro, people are going to do what they want to do. If Tony Mitchell says he's not happy being second or third team, then he's going to do what he, like, what are you going to pay a second or third teamer money to, like, that a starter would get just to keep him there for depth?
And the other guy that gets transferred, they're saying that he's going to go to Oregon. If he's going to go to Oregon, ain't nothing Alabama can do to stop him from going to Oregon.
Right.
Because Oregon got Phil Knight money.
Well, and Peyton Woodyard's from California. He's from out west. That's why I was saying.
Exactly.
I mean, the guy was probably going to leave regardless. I don't even know if it probably was. He probably just maybe felt more comfortable. He wasn't as comfortable as he thought. I don't know. But he's going back to the West Coast more than likely. You got to think he was probably going to do that regardless. And maybe the staff figured he was going to leave.
Buffalo boss man. I mean, Bama boss man. Listen. 8-4. I want you to write this receipt down in pen, okay?
And I want you to write this down, Corey. Two of the highest-rated classes in the history of college football are still presently on the campus of the University of Alabama.
Mm. But yet they can't break the starting lineup.
How do you know?
So they transferred.
I got one question. Then if you can answer this, then I'll say, Corey, you are absolutely right.
Okay.
What does the 2D DB look like for the University of Georgia?
What do you look like?
Yeah, what the 2D, what does it look like right now?
Starters?
Huh?
They look like they could be starting on another team.
Other than starts, name two of them.
Well, I don't keep up with names.
That's what I'm saying. You're going by what you... we don't know.
But why do you know
his name? We don't know, Corey. Huh?
Why do I need to know his name?
Because you're saying that all these other teams have so much more talent than Alabama got. That's why Alabama's going 8-4. But the team that you said is number one, you can't even name two players in the defensive backfield. So how you know how good they are?
I know one thing. They're going to be that way.
If I'm lying, tell me I'm lying.
Well, write this one down. They're going to beat Alabama this year.
Man, see, here he goes again.
And I'm going to hold you to that. And when that game is over with, I'm going to call back.
Buffalo boss man and crow. I'll be right
here. You're going to eat crow. You're going to eat buzzards. You're going to eat a whole lot of stuff.
Eat everything. It's a protein. So I need to eat some buzzards.
And the man coming behind me, KJ, we're going to give it to you. I'm telling you that right now.
Please do, because he's running off all my freaking listeners trying to be funny. So please take care of him. Bama Bossman, we got to hit a break. I appreciate you, man.
I got it right here. I got Bama Bossman receipt right here. Promise you that. I've been this receipt.
Yeah. All right. We'll see about that. KJ coming up next. You're listening to the Miller's Edge right here. Tide 100.9, 1238.
Bundled savings vary by state and are not available in every state. Saving up to 25% is the countrywide average of the maximum available savings off the home policy. Allstate Vehicle and Property Insurance Company and affiliates, Northbrook, Illinois.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
And welcome back into the Miller's Edge, Tide 100.9, 1230 WTPC, presented by the Good Feet Store, America's Art Sport Experts. Real quick, before we go to KJ, I'm looking forward to this one as well. Got to remind you about my good friend, Michael, over at Off-Road Performance Direct. He'll take great care of you for all your truck and lift kit accessory needs. Go check them out. Again, they're in Northport, Alabama. Off-Road Performance Direct. Michael will get you squared away. If you got a truck, SUV, you need some light bars, you need a lift kit, you need a toolbox, all that good stuff, man. They got a huge selection of rims and tires. They can order anything you like, so make sure you go check them out. If you're in the market to get your truck or SUV lifted or done up, again, that's Off-Road Performance Direct. Call Michael at 205-310-1823. And you can also check them out on social media to see all the great work that they do at Off-Road Performance Direct. Again, that is Off-Road Performance Direct. Let's go to Buford.
I'm a boss, man. Check out Kyron Jones. Check out Chris Peel and check out Daniel Harris on the team.
Who?
Daniel Harris, check him out.
No. Did you just Google Chris some Peel names?
And Kyron Jones.
So just check him out. You just Google some names?
Ain't Google anything, just check him out.
Okay. Well, let's check out KJ and see what he has to say about this foolishness that you've been spewing out today.
What is this man talking about, bro, man? Like, he's a hater. Corey, it's official. You're a Bama hater, man. And I hate that you on that side.
Dude, listen. When you sit there and boast 8-4, 8-4, like, that's hating energy. Like, that's lame. Like, again, the show is freaking tied 100.9. That's lame. Like, come on, man.
And it's okay. It's okay. It's a lot of Bama haters out there. So he's just added on to the crew.
But
when Alabama was benefiting them, though, he didn't have nothing to say. But now that it don't benefit them,
Dieter said, I'd be on the phone too long, so I want to make it quick. Even though I don't know why Texas Dieter, I don't know why Texas fan
Digger,
my bad. I don't know why a Texas fan is worried about anything regarding Alabama. Like, he needs to be worried about his head coach being drunk. Like, I don't know.
Oh wow!
Somebody messaged me today. We should have KJ to co-host.
Yeah, they want KJ to co-host. I think Ricky said that. I told KJ, man, shoot, you can come on as often as possible, as much as you want.
All right. Let's get into the people. Isaiah Hamilton. All right, so first of all, I want to say that I agree that we should have tampered better. Like, no doubt about it. We talk about Courtney Morgan, this and that.
You should have tampered better. Right?
You can say it without hating, though. Like, I've already said,
Wait.
They give Courtney Morgan too much praise. I said that. Like, the old staff know what they're doing. They should have included the old staff with this. You know, they would have been able to get probably better names. But let's look at the names that they do have that's visiting. We already missed on Ed Woods. We missed on Jabbar Muhammad. Like, this is truthful. And we missed on Greedy Van. Miss. He went to right? So now we're looking at Isaiah Hamilton. Isaiah Hamilton came from Tanner View High School, Texas. He actually had, like, a pretty good year. He had 4 interceptions. So, I know you know
pretty good. That's really good.
You know the Hurts family. Like, and look what he did against Texas game.
He's a Texas boy.
Ask Avrion, Jalen Hurts' dad about him. Like, I'm sure he'll let you know, what type of player we can get with that.
Did he play for Avrion?
No, yeah, I think he played against him, huh?
I think he played for Avrion.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. He played for Channel View High School.
Oh.
Let me text him right now. What's the kid's name?
His name is Isaiah Hamilton.
Gotcha.
All right.
So then we got the other guy, Deshaun Jones. This guy, I mean, from Wake Forest, you were talking about schools and, you know, he's already had people reach out for him from Georgia, LSU, other schools too. So it's not like he's a bad, he got to be something if they're reaching out to him as well. So, I mean, like I said, the ring to not be a hater, you got to give some plus in there too. Like,
Hamilton, right?
Yeah, Isaiah Hamilton from Houston. But that's my point. Like, you got to look at the bright side, too, a little bit. Like, okay, because to me personally, I feel like we should have tampered better. Y'all knew this was happening. I don't give excuses. I don't want to hear about no portal window, no none of that. I'm looking at the DB coach, and I'm looking at Courtney Morgan. Why did y'all have better names than this? There's a guy, Kobe Young from Texas, right? I mean, we're not from Texas, we're not from Kansas. One of the top DBs. Why didn't you look for him for cornerback? And I know the other caller said second string. These guys are not going to be second string. Whichever one they get, they're playing, they're starting corner opposite Dominic Jackson.
You know, these guys aren't going to come here if they think they're going to be depth pieces. I mean, like, yeah, they are quote unquote depth, but they're going to be first on the depth chart as long as they come here and they are as average.
But that doesn't mean that they can keep their job if they have poor performance.
No. They can get beat out, but the idea, you don't go to the portal for. I agree with you. I mean, even Coach Saban said that you don't ever go to the portal and get depth guys. Except the Charlotte guy. I think this staff might have a different mindset. From what I've heard about the Charlotte guy, they think he's a good player. I mean, they think he's going to compete, and like they're not just going to say, hey, okay, we need a body. Like, he's not just a body to them. Now, yeah, you know, he serves as depth, but they expect him to compete, and they'll see what they got in him. But
was that a linguist pickup too? I don't trust linguists. I can just say that flat out. I don't trust linguists.
I think they got confused with South Alabama instead of Alabama.
Bro, that does not matter, man. You would have said the same thing about Trey Amos. You would have said, what is Nick Saban doing? Why is he getting this guy from school?
Yeah,
bro.
And he's going to
be a first-round cornerback.
I've been a Trey Amos fan.
But he's saying, though, before you got to actually see him suit up in an Alabama uniform, you would have had the same mentality as you do right now.
You would have said, what is Saban doing with that? He already got Kool-Aid and Terry and Arnold. Why is he bringing in Trey Amos?
Here's a big thing y'all don't get. kids development and who are coaching them goes a long way. You know that, right? Who's motivating that athlete, that player, goes a long way. Who can teach said player how to become a top-notch athlete goes a long way. What I'm telling you is I don't have any type of solid
evidence.
But that's different. You saying that, which I agree with. I agree with that take.
The GoCoach Saban person who they got coaching these guys now, I don't.
We agree with that, but what we're saying, Christian, I'm sorry for speaking for you, but I think you probably agree with that too. But what we're saying
No. I do. I have to just go about saying it different ways. I mean,
but that's not what he's doing though. He's knocking kids saying, "Oh, where are you coming from?" Like, you can't like have a hidden point. You got to make the point known. This is, you got to say, okay, this is why I may feel like he may not be developed because he's coming from this school and he's not getting the proper coaching. Like, we got to say that too. I don't trust him getting the proper coaching. Because the only thing we're hearing is they came from Charlotte or they came from a small school, so they can't make it.
So my point when I was saying this earlier was that a blind squirrel finds a nut every now and then. If you go by numbers, these are facts. That smaller school guy, most of them are not going to be that caliber player. That's all I was saying. If you got three or four guys you're looking at from a smaller type program, you might get lucky and one of them be decent. But the higher percentage is that they're not. That's the point I was making. That's the point I'm making.
Then, you got to say that in a way.
Ask me why. My point is, T-Rob, the GOAT Nick Saban, these guys are developer talents. I don't know what you got right now. That's my main point.
Okay, I agree with that. But that's not to say that this guy can't be successful. Like, he may be that squirrel in the nut, which you said. Like, he could be that. He could be that late night.
I just said
that. That late night club that you pick up and she's actually turning to your wife. Like, you never know.
Right. But what's
the chance of that happening?
But in my opinion, though, I mean, like, I think there's also levels still, right? I mean, like, the guy from Charlotte, sure, I think he definitely fits in that, you know, squirrel finds a nut category because, yeah, he's young, he played some snaps, did some good stuff, but he's not like, no, you know what I'm saying, seasoned vet that put it like, but the guys coming on visits, though, stop looking at the school. They led their teams in interceptions. Like, they got to at least have some type of ability, okay? You know what I'm saying? Like, Wake Forest and Houston, again, it's not like coming from
– And not only that, you know who coached the dude from the town of you guys, at Houston? Doug Belt, Alabama guy.
Oh, really?
He coached him.
Oh, man, Doug's a solid dude, man. Good coach, too.
He should have been our cornerback hire, but I ain't going to go there. So.
Did they look into him at all?
Man, Kane Womack,
yeah. I see where you're going there.
Yeah, I'm going to let that go.
KJ, you do a lot of reading. You follow these kids. You know, I know what you do. You tell me all the names and all of this, but you fail to sometimes look at reality, okay? That's what a lot of these folks do. That's covering and giving these star rankings. They read. They call their family.
Oh, by the way, Tony Mitchell and Peyton Woodyard were not 5 stars, by the way, too. My bad. I'm sorry to interrupt you. They were not 5 stars.
Tony Mitchell was like on one site. He might have been one, but he was more of a 4-star tenant.
Doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
Who's giving out these rankings, KJ?
Hey, man, they had a high hit rate, you know, with the 5 stars and the draft class.
KJ, who are giving out these rankings?
I mean, the first round guys from this past draft, a lot of them were 5 stars.
Hey, the geeks getting the information from somewhere. I don't know where these geeks getting it from, but they getting it from somewhere.
Everybody and their grandmother can go tell you the best absolute player that's probably going to make it. What about all the ones that they miss? They don't talk about that. That's all I'm saying.
But where are you going with that, though? I mean,
these dudes giving rankings. People put so much stock in
But that stars. Also that also supports the argument that also supports my argument that if stars don't matter, then why are you judging these guys that they're looking into from smaller schools?
Because these guys, their talent level, like I told
you're making it easy.
Hey, that's
you got a lot of talent level, you got a Citadel talent level, that's where you go play ball at.
Bro, it's a bad take.
Those,
man.
Some of them are pretty easy. Don't take an extra.
All right, man. I hit a loser. I got to wrap up. 10 win season of Alabama this year, y'all. Roll Tide.
I can roll with it. That was KJ from
KJ, what are you drinking?
I don't know, but we'll ask him tomorrow because he got off here. We're going to take a quick timeout. We'll be right back. We've got Jared. We got Ellis. We got others. We got a couple Tide app messages. We'll try to get to you. Listen to the Miller's Edge right here, Tide 100.9, 1230 AM, WTBC. Quick timeout. We'll be right back.
Coming up on The Game with Ryan Fowler.
Coming up on the Wednesday edition of The Game, we're going to talk with Tony Sakatas. We're going to update this transfer portal. Who's in? Who's out? We're going to talk about it with Tony Sakatas from Tide Illustrated Rivals Network of Websites. We'll talk to Coach Pete Jenkins. We're going to talk about defensive line play. Where could this Alabama defense go? We'll talk with Coach Pete Jenkins. Coming up starting at 2 p.m. here on The Game on Tide 100.9, 1230 WTBC, your home of Alabama Crimson Tide Sports.
The longest running sports program.
Trades in the construction field, go to skilledtradesofwestalabama.com and find out more information about the 4-week Jumpstart program and take your first steps towards a rewarding career.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
Mostly sunny and warm this afternoon. The high today 87, fair tonight, the low 62. Tomorrow, partly to mostly sunny, the high 89. Then for Friday, partially sunny, the chance of a few scattered showers by afternoon, the high 86. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 86 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
This is Miller's Edge on Tide 100.9.
Last dance, last chance for love.
This is the last chance to talk with us right here. This is the last segment as the last dance song plays, as the lights turn on in the club at the end of the night. Listening to the Miller's Edge, Tide 100.9. Here we go, right back to the phone lines. We go talk to Jared. Jared, welcome in.
Hey, guys.
What's going on, Jared?
Hey, first thing, I was going to see if, was it Boss Man Bama, if he needs a job, because I'm a regional sales manager, and I don't think that guy would leave the building till he has an order in his hands.
Hey, man, he's always, he's got his facts, though. He's got his facts. I like him.
He wouldn't leave the office until somebody gave him a purchase order of some sort.
Matter of fact, they should hire him as a recruiter. They might be better off.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey, you know what, Corey? At this point, and I'm somewhere in between you and some of the other callers, I tend to panic a little bit about this whole roster thing. We need some bodies. We need the ones. I think we're good. We got to get some sort of depth, even if it's a kid from Charlotte, which when I saw that pop up, I was like, oh, God. But you know what? I would really doubt that if it wasn't for the Trey Amos deal, because I'm from Louisiana, and when we got that kid from UL Lafayette or whatever, I was like, are you kidding me? But then I watched him on the field. He looked pretty good. He played really good in the SEC championship game. Then he goes over to Ole Miss. He could play, so maybe we get that. The other thing is, and you guys, this is really what I call it to say and get your feedback on. But what we have in Xavier Brown and Mbakwe, those guys, Mbakwe was the fastest guy at the Under Armour National game, right? I mean, that dude got blazing speed. And if there's one way to make up for errors as a defensive back, it's with speed. I mean, hell, Deion, he was a great player, but Deion could make up for a mistake because he could come from a dead stop and run you down, you know? And we got that. So if they can coach them boys up to some extent with that type of speed, you can cover up some errors. Get some bodies in.
Right, but you want great technicians. I mean, you want to be able to footwork, hips, you know, hand place when you're playing bump and run coverage, that type of thing. You know, you still need that. You're right, but speaking of Deion, would get beat off the – you know, from just the initial part of the route, right? You know, he opened up his hips or a guy jukes him, but he had that speed to make up that coverage. But that helps you in that area. But if you got a corner like a Terrion Arnold that I felt like was very physical, especially in press man, you know, use his hips because he's not the fat. You know what he ran, 4.55 to come by or something like that. But that, the more you can disrupt the timing of routes as a defensive back, the better you're going to be able to play. And so, you know, if you don't, and this is a major problem across sports, not the NFL and college, right? Nobody jams anymore. Nobody reroutes anymore, which means make him take a different alternative route to get to where he's trying to go. You know, that messes up the timing of the passing route, the patterns. A lot of people don't do that anymore. And you know, that's the problem. So we'll see. I mean, listen, Alabama players have gotten better. That's been the trend. They have gotten better. And that's what you hope. But again, as I said earlier, T-Rob's not there. Nick Saban's not there. He spent all his time with the secondary guys. And that makes me a little nervous about it. And that's why I have stronger beliefs against it.
No, I mean, I agree. But we really don't know what's going on behind the scenes. I would really like to talk to that kid from Arizona State and ask him, what in the world did they agree to or did you see that made you think Michigan State's a better option than Alabama?
Well, I think said something. I think he mentioned that. Didn't he say something about he felt that? No, he actually said something about he felt the coaches at Michigan State could develop him or something like that. I heard somebody say that.
Yeah,
I don't.
He felt like the coach there would give him a better opportunity to get to the next level because.
Good.
Yeah.
Somebody gave him some money. I mean, Michigan State's a dumpster fire. That place has been a disaster for two or three years.
Yeah.
I mean, that's been a bad place to be associated with for two or three years. And the guy goes there, so that just shows you how the landscape changed.
That's not good.
I mean, that's crazy. Crazy that we had a guy go there instead of coming to Bama. But anyways, all right, I'm trying to make myself feel better. You know, I mean,
can't do it today.
So I was trying to make myself feel a little bit better with my speed story. I'm sticking to it. I'm going to stick to that to make me feel better about it. But we haven't even seen Mbakwe on the field yet at practice, right? He's not even he didn't early enroll, right?
Yeah, well, he was there the first spring. So I mean, you got to see him on this field. And if I'm being honest with you, I mean, he's running with the twos. I think he's going to still need some more time to develop. I mean, that's probably why they have a guy like Xavier Brown working with the ones. He's probably a little bit further along. Red Morgan's further along. Matter of fact, I think Mbakwe's behind Red. But, so he's still going to need some time to develop, but going to be a good player. He's got, you know, the skill set, all the tools, just got to continue just working. But, again, the guy should be in high school right now, so it's expected. But, Jared, we're going to try to squeeze Ellis on here for the last minute. We told him yesterday he's going to get on here. But thanks, as always, for calling in, man. We'll talk soon, brother.
Let's get Ellis on.
We got to get Ellis on for the last couple of minutes. Bad. Well, we got to go in order now. I mean, it's not intentional. Ellis, welcome in, sir.
Howdy, how's it going? Hey, I didn't hang up yesterday. I just heard you mention to tell me to call back tomorrow, so I just went ahead and just hung up.
Yeah, no. You're good, man. You're good.
I ain't heard your voice in a couple of weeks, man. You okay?
Oh, yeah. Cleaning, got through with the house now. I'm cleaning a sports utility vehicle.
Oh, nice.
I got
washing.
I need to throw some wax on it.
Need a coat of wax. This right here, Don, but it's got leather seats. Just giving it a good thorough cleanup.
Nice.
Make that money.
Make that money, honey.
Hey, legal. Any way is possible, make money legal, I'll do it. Wash cars, wash a house, clean a house. You know,
will you go get some cornerbacks for Alabama illegally?
Well, we're going to be 10-2 this coming up year.
You going 10-2?
You better. I think we're going to have to order some crow because you're going to be eating a lot of crow there, of course.
You tell them, Ellis. You tell them.
A whole truckload of it.
Ellis, if they don't go 10-2, when I'm bringing my Suburban down to Tuscaloosa, you going to wax it for free?
Yeah, I'll come down there and wax it for free if they do that.
Okay.
I sure will.
They don't, I'm going to buy you a nice steak at the best steakhouse in Alabama.
Then we can go over there we can go to the cigar place and smoke a cigar.
Yeah,
there you go.
Do that too.
That's a good deal. Well, Ellis, we got to make room for Ryan Fowler. We appreciate you as always, man. Sorry. We've been loaded on the phone.
No. I'm the fan. I just appreciate you letting me talk.
Absolutely, man. We'll talk soon, Ellis.
Boy, my truck on the wheel, that wax you put on.
All right, we got to get out of here. Ryan Fowler is going to he's going to kick me out of the chair in a second. Appreciate everybody listening. This has been the Miller's Edge right here on Tide 100.9, 12:30 a.m. WTBC, presented by the Good Feet Store, America's R-Sport expert.